coming up on Need to Know, a special program devoted to the 50th anniversary of the Rochester riots. Disparities in employment, troubled police relations, racism in housing, and concentrated poverty, among other issues, plagued certain neighborhoods and residents in our community 5 decades ago. And 50 years later, we ask the question, how far have we come? National author and speaker Bruce Jacobs and members of the WXXI News Team help answer that question. It's all coming up right now on the special edition of Need to Know. This has been a week of reflection in Rochester. Over the past several days, community agencies, colleges and universities, libraries, city officials, news organizations, and many others have gathered to remember the events of July 1964. Many of you are familiar with this story. During a street dance on Joseph Avenue on July 24th, 50 years ago, an arrest ignited a three-day riot in two predominantly African-American neighborhoods. The world watched as a city riddled with racial disparities in education, employment, housing, and health care appeared to fall apart. While advances have been made since 1964, are they enough? And what does it take to really unite a community? I sat down with national author and Rochester native Bruce Jacobs to find out. Jacobs takes on such disparities in his book, Race Manners. All right, and Bruce, just to begin, I'm interested to learn about your experiences as a young boy in Rochester during the 64 riots. And before you do that, I just want to read what you wrote in Race Manners, Navigating the Minefield Between Black and White Americans.
Sure.
And you wrote, "What was it like for those people in Rochester, New York? I don't know for certain who they were, but I have an idea, who signed the petition protesting my family's moving into our new house in a white neighborhood. What was it like to be that drunken white man in dirty clothes who thrust his leg as if to trip me, a black stranger in a business suit as I walked past him on the bus? What was it like for black kids who lie in wait to pummel any white stranger who happens to come along? I don't know. Chances are you don't either. If you did, you would not have this book in your hand." So I just wanted to know exactly, A, how old were you at that time and what you remember from those 3 days?
Sure. Well, what I wrote reflects the reason that I felt the need to write these books. There are two in a row now. The second one is Race Manners for the 21st Century. And they're both sort of kitchen table books about how this stuff works, how we decode it, what we do with it in our personal and political lives. And I was 8 years old in 1963 when we moved into that house on Harvard Street on the east side of Rochester from the west side, which at that point was mostly black, just about all black. And we were one of the first, if not the first, black families, non-white families, people of color, to move onto that street. There was a petition, and that whole story as it unfolded was, you know, unfortunately a really common story of how society learns to move forward and learns to deal. We dealt, we weren't going anywhere, and people dealt and people grew, and it's part of where I grew up. So I was nine when the riots happened in 1964. And by that time, we had just started to make ourselves at home in this neighborhood, and you know, the kids calling me the N-word on the street and the sort of settling into who were my friends and who weren't my friends was going on. And I grew up in a household of ideas. Our parents talked about things. We had books around. I can still remember seeing Ralph Ellison's The Invisible Man on the shelf in the living room and thinking that it was like the monster story of the Invisible Man, right? And then I opened it and read it. I was like, whoa, well, this isn't a fun book.
You know?
And later I came to appreciate what it was. So they both exposed us to, in fact, we're part of, very tangibly, the struggle for equal treatment, both in how they lived their lives and the kind of advocacy that my mother did. She was big in voter registration and did a lot of things in Rochester to try to change things.
And I want to say, and you said it's common, you know, what you experience is a common.
Yeah, it's not at all unique.
It happened to my parents. I mean, these are experiences that my parents dealt with, my brother has dealt with, I have had these experiences. And I want to know, what do we do with them? Right, we've got these experiences, and your book, it serves as this guidebook of sorts when these are practical things that happen to this day and how we can go about dealing with them, because we have a choice in how we deal with them. So what do we do with these experiences? Is there a way to make them for good?
Well, I don't know that we ever make them, well, to make them for good in the sense of making them be for the course of positive movement, yes. They're never permanent in the sense of being for good, because we're always growing and we live in this soup of racism and of misogyny and of all sorts of creation and sustaining of barriers that make it hard. So we continually have to do this. It requires active work to kind of stay in the same place and move ahead. But what I write in my books and what I say when I speak is that it's a combination of empathy and of standing firm in a way that separates bad behavior from bad personhood. There is a way to acknowledge and love a person's personhood, and I write explicitly about this in Race Manners for the 21st Century, that empowers you to even more strongly confront their bad beliefs and their bad behavior, in your view. And it works the same way and the opposite. I mean, a person can and has many times, people have done this, and they ought to, have embraced my essential personal goodness and used that as a jumping off point to say, but you know that thing you said or that thing you did or that thing I saw you do or heard you say was really hurtful or was really wrong or didn't reflect something that I know from my experience to be true. And I need to call you on that because I expect more of you as the person I know you to be. And that's the starting point for some of those conversations. Of course, none of that is a substitute for certain kinds of political and economic change to change the structures that create and sustain this. I mean, you know, nothing, there's no personal, interpersonal, conversational substitute for Brown versus Board of Education. And that's part of what I talk, you know, what I came to town to talk about at the library in the talk about the anniversary of the events of July 64.
I want to ask you about this, inequality in terms of jobs, housing, education, law enforcement, issues that in a sense sparked the riots of 50 years ago this week. I wanted to get your take. You live in Baltimore now. You lived in Rochester for 30 years.
That's right.
You have friends and family here. You come back to fish. We talked about this.
I sure do.
I want to know, in your observations when you've been back, what has changed? And people say to me, it's really difficult to compare apples to apples when looking at then versus now. Mm-hmm. But have you seen any advancements in terms of some of those issues that I mentioned?
I have, and of course, I've seen those everywhere. Yeah. I can't talk, and I don't want to talk with any specificity here about what's changed and to what degree in Rochester, because I haven't lived here for so long. I've observed some things. I know a lot of people here. I'm connected here. I have impressions. But what I am comfortable doing is saying what I know has changed in a general way nationally, and I believe have also changed and not changed in Rochester. For example, in 1964 and in 2010, when the last census was taken, in that period of time, the black African American unemployment rate remained roughly twice that of whites. And during that same period of time, the black poverty rate, the African American poverty rate, remained essentially three times that of whites. In 1964, and I think this is probably true of Rochester, it's a national kind of reality, sort of a ground state of a starting point. That was in 1964. It was three times, blacks were three times more likely to be poor than whites, and that's still true today. And the same is true of being unemployed. In terms of law enforcement, we know really tangibly what the scenario looked like if you watch the film. I know it's been screened here on WXXI, which I think is terrific because it's a great film, July 64. shows explicitly, and a lot of us and a lot of people, including people older than I who have seen it and lived through things that I didn't see because I was too young, can testify to that. A lot of things were in place there that aren't, in terms of explicit legal segregation, fire hosing people being viewed as okay, police dogs, you know, being let loose in churches. There's an incident reported actually in the film in which that happens, where an officer comes in armed with a police dog at 11 a.m. in a black church on a Sunday morning. But since then, there are other ways in which many things have worsened. For example, the proliferation of guns nationwide has, among other things, decimated many poor communities of color, where now the kind of frustration that youth, particularly young black men and young men of color, feel manifests in the ability to blow somebody away in an instant with the pull of a trigger. That did not used to be true. And the carnage and the impact, including in Baltimore, where I live, and I know in Rochester, where I used to live, is tangible. Educationally, schools' achievement, student achievement, is worse, particularly among poor students of color. And I think it's fair to say this is true in Rochester, than it was in 1964. And there are a lot of reasons for that, including privatization and the sort of lack of political will to support public education the way that it used to be supported. Another way is what you might call the school-to-prison pipeline. Michelle Alexander wrote a book called Mass Incarceration as the New Jim Crow, which is a very incisive scholarly analysis of how the huge incredible, like almost exponential growth of a for-profit prison industry has dovetailed with a lot of the kind of awful sorts of damaging things that have happened in poor communities of color to literally funnel particularly young black and brown men into prisons. And that has decimated all sorts of things in communities, including families, including the opportunities for sort of, you know, healthy community life, and what happens to people when they come out of prison. So in all those respects and many more, there are things we're dealing with now that we didn't have to deal with in 64. So it's a continuum, and I think that's important when we talk about, you know, there's a conversation going on here about whether it was a riot or a rebellion. I like the word insurrection because it includes elements of what happens with both, which is actually what happened and what usually does. But underlying it are forces at play that we have to understand without simply saying, well, it's an event that happened and it's like a volcano that went off and it's over. It's not over. It's still going on, in a sense. You could say there's a riot, there's an insurrection still going on. And in order to address it and deal with it, we have to look at the forces at play.
All right, Bruce Jacobs, thank you for your time.
It's so much a pleasure to be with you.
Appreciate
thank you, Helen.
Observations made by Bruce Jacobs mirror some of the findings reported by the WXXI News Team. For the past several weeks, our newsroom has been out in the community, meeting with local residents, law enforcement, business owners, elected officials, and others for a special series airing every day this week on WXXI Radio called Lessons from July 64. The idea isn't to solely look back at the riots of 1964, but to examine the issues that sparked the 3 days of violence, the ripple effect through the years, and to get a better gauge on how some of those issues are playing out today in Rochester. Joining me for this reporters' roundtable are members of the WXXI News Team, Morning Edition host Beth Adams, reporter Michelle Faust, All Things Considered host Alex Crichton, and reporter Carlette Claire. Thank you all for being here.
Thank you.
So, Beth, I want to start with you because you focused on Joseph Avenue, which was the epicenter of the riots 50 years ago. And I want to know, you know, how things stand right now in terms of for business owners, for families, for developers. But before we get into that, what happened on Joseph Avenue after the riots, particularly when it comes to business owners?
Well, business owners had a very difficult time. Their businesses were vandalized and looted, hundreds of them. Many were driven out by fear. Not all of them were, though. Some of them were leaving for economic reasons, leaving that neighborhood because when they had to repair the vandalism and replace the products that had been stolen from their stores, their insurance premiums shot up. And these were mom and pop stores. And they had a very narrow margin of profit usually. So when your most of your profit is going to your insurance premium, it's difficult to stay in business.
Remember, business owners on Joseph Avenue, they formed an association really to restore, revive that old corridor. And I wanted to find out, what's the long-term plan for that area? And is there evidence of things happening right now to show that a revitalization could be coming?
Just in the last few weeks, we're starting to see small but visible changes in the neighborhood. The Neighborhood Association formed officially several years ago, and they do have a short-term and a long-term plan. What we've seen this summer, just in the last couple of weeks, are banners going up. A colored banner was created for the Joseph Avenue neighborhood. They're up on lampposts. There are bike racks there. Those are going to be decorated. They're planning by the end of the summer to have five artistic murals on walls like we've seen elsewhere in the city. Sort of a way to say something's going on here, people care what's happening here. Because without those attractive elements in a neighborhood, the rest of it won't happen. They would like to get businesses there, not just the corner store on every block. They want a dry cleaner, a meat market, a florist, a flower shop there in the neighborhood to bring it back some of its former vibrancy. But the folks I talked to said they don't expect it to look like it did pre-1964. This is going to be a new Joseph Avenue. And it's happening at a time when cities are becoming re-urbanized. You're seeing this move back into the city, and I think that could be part of this.
Well, Carlette, I want to tie in the housing issue. And this is something that you focused on with your reporting and the possibility of the housing situation being the root cause of the riots. And this, you talked to a number of people in connection to this. I want to find out, who did you talk to and what did you find out in terms of that?
Well, I spoke to John Ryan of Ryan Murphy Associates, and he's an appraiser, so he was talking about the area, the market in that Joseph Avenue area is very suppressed. He said that it was more or less like an entry-level housing area for a large immigrant population came in there, probably Germans, Irish, had a large Jewish population, and then African-Americans came into that neighborhood around in the 50s. Around in that time, the houses in that Joseph Avenue neighborhood are a little over 70 years old. So, but when people were moving into the neighborhood, they didn't necessarily have the means to purchase homes. And Jobs, who I spoke to, the Commissioner of Neighborhood and Business Development, Del Smith, and he was just speaking about how jobs are a number one issue, and families didn't have the income, so they weren't able to maintain those houses. So a lot of, over the years, the houses have just gone down. They've deteriorated. Many homes were abandoned. One of the things that I spoke to, or one of the things that I realized during my conversations with people were that the lead paint poisoning prevention ordinance that was put into effect in Rochester in 2006 was a good effort to make sure that families and children were safe from lead paint poisoning. However, it kind of hurt the market, because families didn't have the necessary means to bring those housing standards up to par. Yeah. So that there were a couple of conflicting things that helped with the housing issue.
In terms of rehabbing, revitalizing houses in particular, is this something that is an effort, the city, an ongoing effort with the city?
Yes.
Right now? Are we seeing this happen?
Yes, the city is working really hard to integrate different economic income levels. So what they're trying to do is mix in those who may be at a poverty level with those who have a higher medium income, and they feel that that would somehow they could work together. So they're working to bring in more people and share that kind of thing, but at the same time they are putting in, I think, $2 million to try to bring up the neighborhood, work on the assets that they already have. So in the Northeast neighborhood, it would be the public market.
Let's weave in police and community relations, because this is an important topic. This is an area of focus for you, Michelle, and really looking at the strained relationship between police and members of communities of color at that time. You talked with Deputy Chief of Operations for the Rochester Police Department, Fred Bell, who joined the RPD a few years after the riots. And what you reported on, this really struck me when I heard it. He said community relations didn't even exist at that time between the force and residents out in the community. And I wanted you to share a little bit more about that and how that's changed.
Yeah, the one thing that he said is that they didn't speak to anyone except God, and he needed an appointment. That was
exactly what
he would say. And it was just a different way of looking at police. I spoke to a lot of criminal justice professors as well that said, you know, police at the time looked at, we enforce the laws, very militaristic point of view, and not necessarily taking the community into effect. They're not thinking about what the community is thinking. There is a movement towards more community policing, and especially with a reorganization right now in the police department, it's hoping to get people actually on the ground, walking through communities, getting to know people and getting to know them as individuals. Hopefully, they'll be able to fight crime that way, but also have a less antagonistic relationship with the community. A lot of people in Rochester right now, there is some distrust still that exists. The people that I spoke to who were alive in 64 and were teenagers in 64, they say they see a big difference. But some young African-American males that I've spoken to who are young now say they don't necessarily know a difference, that they've seen a lot of problems. And there's definitely been controversial events, especially in the last year, that have happened.
Right. Work in progress with gaps that still exist. And Alex, media coverage at that point in time, very, very different in terms of how I think things would look and sound today, and based on the reports that you cover, I'm sure you would agree. How did the media cover the events of the riot, and particular language? Because I know you've got an interesting thing with that.
Yeah, well, I did talk with Warren DeRemus. He's been a longtime reporter, or was a longtime reporter, in the Rochester market. I mean, it's something like 45 years at Channel 10. Back in those days, he and his photographer would go out and actually film what was going on, take it back to the station, and process it there. And what they did was that they'd run the live, raw film about what was happening that night. But as far as the newspaper goes, I'm going to read a couple actual headlines from 1964. These were actual headlines of the Democrat and Chronicle from July of 64. Negro mob riots here, white lured into Negro trap, and Negro priest tries in vain to quell rioting mob. So obviously the language obviously would not be used today that we heard back in 1964. And we also had a chance to talk with Dick Moss, an investigations editor at the Democrat and Chronicle. He's been there for almost 30 years, and he readily admitted that looking at the coverage from back then, it was really from a police point of view, from the National Guard point of view. You really didn't get the point of view of the people taking part in the riots or the leaders in the African-American community back then.
We've got about a minute left, and I want to get your take on this, because something that was part of our assignment was to look at, you know, these issues that sparked the riots in 64. While we can't compare them apples to apples, we know that many of them still exist today. And is there a sense, in terms of the folks that you talk to, that these issues, because they're still present, could in fact, in a sense, lead to a riot or rebellion, however you want to call it, that could happen again?
Well, I'll chime in on that. Everyone that I spoke to said the main thing, the main reason they do not believe that would happen again is that there's more pressure relief valves. There's more organizations that are trying to prevent the problems and the tension between police and the community, even though we still do have a lot of problems. And the one problem that everyone mentioned to me, education.
Carlette, what about you? Because I think you had a differing perspective on that.
Spoke to the city, and they said if people don't get jobs, if the poverty does not get reversed, that we could see another 1964 riot happening. So the pressures are still there in terms of housing, and the poverty is great. So if that doesn't get repaired, they say we possibly could see some sort of uprising.
I spoke to people who said the poverty situation is not just something you're seeing in the African American community now, it's something community wide since the recession.
All right, well, it's great to have all of you here. Thanks for joining me today. It feels good having my team here with me. Carlette Claire, Alex Crichton, Michelle Faust, and Beth Adams, thank you all for your time today. And you can hear all of the radio reports from the WXXI series, Lessons from July 64. Just go to our website, WXXINews.org, and click on the link, Lessons from July 64, on the top of the page. Looking back to better move forward. That's the aim of an exhibit at the University of Rochester's Rush Reese Library. On this anniversary of the 64 riots, the U of R is offering a taste of where the city has been and the direction in which it's working to go. Need to Know's Carlette Claire took a tour of the exhibit this week and shares this report.
The title of the exhibit is Beyond Rochester's 64 Riots, 50 years seeking to make one city out of two. There are eight cases here, but I'm going to highlight just a few of them, not all of them.
Let's take a look at some of those collections
that
you have here.
Okay, so let's move now to the second case here. It is painful for me to include these in this exhibit, even now, but there's no better, no more forceful way to draw one in to the severity, the violence, the devastation. And that the riots brought to the city. This one in particular with the use of the hoses. So now I'd like to move to the second, third, and fourth cases. This case shows the variety of reactions and explanations for why the riots happen. The mayor of the city, Frank Lamb, his response was, and here's a quote, "So we had all kinds of discussions that early evening, and people were stunned to how could this happen in Rochester, you know, an affluent eastern city that had a reputation of being very benevolent and generous." Another perspective was that of Daryl Porter. Now, Daryl now has been part of city government in the previous administration, but then Daryl was a gang leader for the group called the Matadors. And Daryl said this, "When all the rioting was going on, this made the mayor and the city get up off their high horses and want to come to see what was going on and why it was going on. So since it happened, now everybody's getting down to talk about it. And I think there should be a little bit more change in this world." Now, in this next case, we move on just a little bit farther in time. So the first responders, you could say, were the leaders of churches in Rochester. There was a group, it was a cross-racial group. They all, black and white, realized that what needed to happen was to create a disciplined organization of African Americans who could start articulating their needs and working to bring about change among themselves. Okay, so we fast forward to the current time because we all recognize, we did not want to leave this exhibit with 1964. There's still issues, but there are good efforts to address these problems. One of which was the symposium on education that President Seligman set up soon after Mayor Lovely Warren's inauguration, noting that education is one of the big concerns for the community. It's educational, and hope that it doesn't stop with education, but spurs one on to want to make a difference oneself.
Phyllis Andrews, the curator of the exhibit, shared a quote with me during our walkthrough of the showcase. It's by Atticus Finch and Harper Lee's To Kill a Mockingbird. "You never really understand a person until you consider the things from his point of view, until you climb into his skin and walk around in it." My videographer, Marty Kaufman, and I spent some time on Joseph Avenue this week to listen to the hopes, thoughts, and concerns of the people who live there. I asked them to share what they would like to see in their neighborhood over the next 50 years, and this is what they had to say.
"I would like to see more like bakeries and like a family drugstore, things like that, you know. And well, back when I grew up in the 50s, 60s, 70s, it was more family oriented. It was more things for family people to do."
"I think my community just need more fun stuff for the children.
They just need to put more money into funding of jobs and houses and stuff, because I'm seeing more and more people getting homeless, younger people, you know, so it's getting hard."
"I'm a new business owner. I've just opened up a salon across the street from Jack's Fish Market, and I just like to see more cops patrolling the area because there's a lot of violence in this area."
"I would like to see more freedom where people just can walk, sit out without worrying about somebody coming up behind them, doing anything to them, stuff like that."
And that's it for this special edition of Need to Know. Thank you for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. And thank you for your continued support of news and public affairs programming on WXXI. I'll see you next week.